What we learned in testing these kits is that it was useful to test the stranger rape cases. Absolutely, we got a lot of CODIS identified hits of this is a identified offender that could be the suspect of this crime. We also saw that it was very helpful to test the non-stranger cases. We did have documented cases of serial sexual assaults where the perpetrator had raped multiple individuals that he knew. What we also found that was interesting with the non-stranger rape cases is that some of those hit to previously unsolved crimes in other jurisdictions. So there was a DNA sample in CODIS that they didn't have the offender identified for, and it was just sort of holding in the forensic side of CODIS to see if later there would be a match. Ironically, the Detroit Project found the match. When we tested a kit that was associated with a non-stranger rape, meaning we had an identified perpetrator from the victim's statement, that then helped solve potentially a crime in another jurisdiction. So from those experiences, our team really came to appreciate that there is a lot of utility in testing both stranger and non-stranger sexual assault kits. We also learned that there was tremendous utility in testing the quote-unquote really old kits, the ones that we thought were beyond the statute of limitations, and indeed may still be beyond the statute of limitations. We saw a CODIS hit rate for those cases comparable to cases that were still within the statute of limitations, meaning the old kits are still yielding hits and the not quite so old kits are still yielding hits. And again, we've had cases where the information from those old kits, the ones beyond the statute of limitations, has been useful in pursuing current cases because the offender did reoffend.